أم طلاب، محاضرتنا لهذا اليوم راح we are talking about very important subject which is the oxygen hemoglobin relationship and oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. But first let me remind you with the structure of hemoglobin. As we said, hemoglobin consists of four globin chain. Each globin chain attached to heme molecule. And in this heme molecule, we have iron ion, which bind to oxygen reversibly. كل مولكيول من هذه الجلوبين من ترتبط مع الأكسجين اللي راح يصير بيها the first molecule of globin bind to oxygen, it will causes a change in its configuration. And by this, it will expose a more binding site for oxygen. So the affinity of the second, third, fourth molecules will increase the affinity for oxygen. Okay, هذه العلاقة نسميها positive cooperativity. يعني معناتها ارتباط الأولى مع الأكسجين زيد the affinity of the other molecules for oxygen. فنسميها positive cooperativity. هذا نشوفها بالبلد اللي هو in the arterial blood. هذا لأنه partial pressure of oxygen in that side is high. والبلد يكون re-oxygenated. بينما بالvenous side راح يكون partial pressure low. زين. نجي هسه للهيموغلوبين أكسجين dissociation curve. هذا بالحقيقة الكيرف يمثل العلاقة بين partial pressure of oxygen والpercentage of hemoglobin saturation with oxygen أو الaffinity of hemoglobin for oxygen. مثل ما قلنا إنه إحنا الaffinity هي أو binding of hemoglobin for oxygen هي positive cooperativity، وقلنا كل ما يكون الconcentration مالت الأكسجين عالي راح يصير ارتباط المولكيول الأولى أول شيء يسهل لي عملية ارتباط المولكيولز الباقية. قلنا positive cooperativity فأكيد راح أشوف هذا linear shape. بس الحقيقة هذا الكيرف شكله sigmoid shape. ليش sigmoid shape؟ أول شيء بدي linear، مو صحيح؟ لأنه قلنا هذا يزيد هذا يزيد، لكن يوصل إلى مرحلة إنه الهيموغلوبين هو fully saturated with oxygen. فهنا من يكون fully saturated يعني وصل 100% أكيد إذا حتى لو يتغير عندي الأكسجين concentration ما راح يأثر على الهيموغلوبين saturation أو الأفينيتي of hemoglobin for oxygen. فلذلك راح نوصل مرحلة نسموها plateau phase. أوكي؟ زين، هذا الحالة الاعتيادية. هذا الكيرف ممكن يصير بـ change shifting to the right or to the left. شلون؟ مثلا هسه احنا عندنا خلينا نفترض شفت of the أول شيء خلينا ناخذ بالحالة الاعتيادية إنه هسه أنا عندي ال concentration of oxygen 50. فإذا أجي على ال red line اللي هو النورمال أجي أباوع هذا ال 50 إيش قد يقابله ال saturation of hemoglobin. خلينا نفترض هنا أنا مو 100 وإنما تقريبا 60%. هذا 60% of hemoglobin saturated لما أول ال affinity for hemoglobin for oxygen is 60. percent هاي لما يكون عندي concentration of oxygen 50. مني الكيرف هذا shifted to the right، هذا الكيرف shifted to the right البلو، أخذ نفس الشيء لما يكون عندي concentration 50. خلي أشوف saturation of hemoglobin زاد لو قل من أقارنة بالريد أشوفه أقل، مو صحيح؟ معناته شنو؟ معناته affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen is low. يعني شنو معناته؟ يعني معناته راح يصير عندي الـ release of oxygen from hemoglobin راح ينطي، مو هالشكل؟ لأنه معناته الـ affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen قلت فيفك ارتباطه بسهولة. هاي شو وقت نشوفها؟ نشوفها بحالة الـ exercise. المصل during exercise تحتاج أكسجين، صح لو لا؟ فإذا الكيرف راح يصير shifted to the right حتى يصير release للأكسجين. إذا أول شيء صار عندي during exercise increase temperature. الـ pH أيضا لما تكون عندي low pH يعني acidity. ايش وقت هاي يصير؟ من يكون عندي increase CO2، صح لو لا؟ بالاكسرسايز وبالتشو عندك increase CO2 فتحتاج انت اكسجين، فهذه واحدة من الفاكت ايضا. اذا increase CO2, acidity, low pH, increase temperature او increase diphosphoglyceride، كلها هذه تسوي shifting to the right. الابوزيت مالته شيفتنج اوف ذا كيرف تو ذا ليفت. شلون يصير؟ لما يكون عندي هسه هنا الاكسجين كونسنتريشن 50 والكيرف شيفتد تو ذا ليفت، لاحظ الساتوريشن اوف هيموغلوبين قارن ليا ويا الريد، زاد لو قل؟ زاد. معناته شنو؟ معناته الافينيتي اوف هيموغلوبين فور اكسجين زادت، يعني ما يفك ارتباطه بسهوله من الـ من الـ من الهيموغلوبين. هاي شو وقت نشوفها؟ نشوفها باللانجز، مو صحيح؟ لانه البايندينج مال الاكسجين للهيموغلوبين اكثر باللانك. ليش؟ لان هناك عندي شيفتنج اوف ذا كيرف تو ذا ليفت، السي او 2 قليل، ديكريز سي او 2، وعندي ديكريز تمبريتشر وديكريز 2 3 ديفوسفوجليسرايد، كلها هذه تسوي عندي شيفتنج اوف ذا كيرف تو ذا ليفت. اوكي زين، هذا السبجكت اللي هو الاكسجين هيموغلوبين ديسوسيشن. بالنسبه للاريثرو بويسز، تذكرون اللي هي عمليه الجينريشن اوف ذا ريد بلاد سيلز فروم ذا بون مورو، قلنا اسمها اريثرو بويسز، وقلنا اكو فد هرمون اللي هو اسمه الاريثرو بويتين اللي هو play important role in the regulation of erythropoiesis. الإريثروبويتين نعتبره هو very play important role in erythropoiesis. وعن this erythropoietin بالحقيقة الريليز مالته يكون أهم شيء، أي شيء سوينا هايبوكسية راح يسوي stimulate the release of erythropoietin، وبالتالي stimulate the generation of the red blood cell. الفاكتورز اللي يسوينا هايبوكسيا many factors، مثلا patient anemic as a result of hemorrhage as a result of disease. ف anemic patient معناته decrease in the oxygen amount so hypoxia so erythropoietin stimulation release stimulated. زين، any condition causes destruction of the major portion for the of the bone marrow by a disease or by exposure to radiation it will causes a hyperplasia of the remaining bone marrow and attempt to supply the deficient amount of the red blood cells. Also in high altitude, in high altitude there is hypoxia, low level of oxygen, and this will stimulate the release of erythropoietin to increase the amount of the red blood cells to overcome the reduce in the oxygen level. Also we have various diseases either in the heart or in the respiratory system which cause decrease in the level of oxygen it will stimulate the production of the red blood cell by the increase by increasing the level of erythropoietin. Okay, so the main stimulator for the release of erythropoietin is hypoxia. When the high erythropoietin is released it will stimulate the generation of the it will enhance the production of the red blood cells. Now the erythropoietin mainly formed in the kidneys. About 90% of the erythropoietin formed in the kidney, but the other 10% is from the liver and other tissues. So we have renal and non-renal precursor of erythropoietin. we have the some individual who are having a disease in their kidneys, or they have a removal of the kidney by surgery. They undergo, they become anemic due to the deficiency in the erythropoietin. So there is decrease in the amount of the red blood cells. Now the we are talking about the as we said here, let me show you the hypoxia will stimulate the release of erythropoietin because there is decrease in the oxygen level. Erythropoietin will be stimulated. It will stimulate the synthesis of the red blood cells from the bone marrow. So the amount of the red blood cells is increased, which means the carrying capacity for oxygen is increased. So the hypoxia is corrected. And now a feedback will come to the kidney to decrease the amount of erythropoietin release. So the erythropoietin production is depend on the amount of oxygen in the body. Now we are talking about the relationship between the vitamin B12 and the folic acid with the formation of the red blood cells. The vitamin B12 and folic acid play important role in the DNA. It is the building unit exactly for the synthesis and for the synthesis of the DNA, which play important role in the cell division and maturation. So the deficiency of vitamin B12 and folic acid causes a decrease in the DNA, and this will affect the cellular maturation and division, and result in abnormal shape red blood cells, which become large size, and it will called the macrocytic cell. And because the shape of the cell is changed, as we know, the normal shape of the RBCs is biconcave shape, and it have an elastic membrane which make them easily pass through the normal blood through the narrow blood vessels. But when their shape is changed, this cell, the cell membrane of this cell become very delicate and irregular, so it will be fragile easily when it pass through the narrow blood vessels, and it will have a short lifespan, and they will die prematurely, causing anemia of the subjects, and it's what called the macrocytic anemia. The vitamin B12 either diminished either in diet due to decrease in the amount of vitamin B12 or folic acid in the diet, or could be due to a defect in the parietal cells of the stomach. And as we know, the parietal cells of the stomach is responsible for the release of intrinsic factor, and intrinsic factor play important role in the absorption of the vitamin B12 and folic acid. Intrinsic factor will bind with vitamin B12 when it reaches the stomach, and it by its binding it will protect the vitamin B12 from the acidity of the gastric secretion, so it will be it will not digested. Also, it will carry the vitamin B12 to the terminal ileum, where the absorption take place, because in the terminal ileum there is a specific there is a special receptors which are specific receptor for the have a binding site, and the intrinsic factor will bind to this specific receptor, and
holding the vitamin B12 to be absorbed. So it will facilitate the absorption of the vitamin B12 because it will bind to these receptors. Now we are talking about the formation of the hemoglobin. The formation of hemoglobin is started earlier in the red blood cells. It will begin in the pro-erythroblast, and it will continue until the reticulocytes when it leaves the bone marrow, and it will increase in its amount. The hemoglobin, as we said, consists of globin portion, and this globin, it consists of a polypeptide chain. So it has sequences of amino acid which form this polypeptide chain. The arrangement of these amino acids within the polypeptide chain determine the type of the hemoglobin. We have four types of polypeptide chain: alpha, beta, delta, gamma. The most common hemoglobin, which is hemoglobin A, this type of hemoglobin consists of two alpha and two beta chain. Any change in the amino acid will cause a change in the polypeptide chain and then the type of the hemoglobin. Sometime the change in the amino acid also, it will affect the affinity of the hemoglobin to oxygen. The affinity of hemoglobin to oxygen is changed with the change in the shape of the globin chain. So in some type of anemia, which is called sickle cell anemia, in which the amino acid valine is replacing glutamate, we will having a change in the amino acid, so we will have a new type of globin chain, and so the affinity, as we say, the affinity of the hemoglobin for oxygen will be changed. In those individuals with sickle cell anemia, when they are exposed to a hypoxia, the cytoplasm of these individuals, of the red blood cell, the cytoplasm containing the crystals, which when exposed to hypoxia, these crystals become coarse, elongated, and causing damage to the interior, to the cell membrane. And it will cause a rupture of the cell and result to sickle cell anemia. So the lifespan of the this cell, sickle cell, is shorter than the lifespan of the normal red blood cells. Because as we said, these cells, due to the presence of these crystals, when exposed to hypoxia, this crystal causing damage of the cell membrane, so it will end the life of these cells solely. هذه محاضرتنا. شكرا جزيلا.